In this video, you will be acquainted with the Statement of Financial Position, the Statement of Comprehensive Income, how to use those statements to calculate a firm's cash flow, and finally, we'll briefly talk about sources and uses of cash. The Statement of Financial Position depicts a firm's assets on the left-hand side and liabilities and equity on the right-hand side. Let's examine each in greater detail. Assets are what a firm owns. There are two kinds, current and fixed. Current assets are things that convert to cash within 12 months. One example is inventory, as inventoried items typically sell within a year. Fixed assets, on the other hand, are long-lived and typically provide value for more than 12 months. Things such as the actual manufacturing plant and equipment are tangible, or physical assets. Intellectual properties like trademarks and copyrights are intangible. Assets are listed in order of highest to lowest liquidity. For now, it's enough to know that the more liquid an asset, the faster it can be converted to cash, with lower loss of value in the process. That's why cash is always listed first. Gold is another highly liquid commodity. On the other hand, a fixed asset like a highly customized manufacturing plant would be highly illiquid. Liabilities, on the other hand, are what a firm owes. Just like there are current and fixed assets, there are current liabilities and long-term debt. Current liabilities are debts that come due within 12 months, and long-term debts are debts that must be repaid at some time after 12 months. People that have loaned the company money are known as creditors or bondholders. Below liabilities is equity. Equity is the amount of funding the owners, or shareholders, put into the company, plus retained earnings from operations. Notice that the totals on both sides are the same. This is because the underlying principle of a statement of financial position is that assets equal liabilities plus equity. A quick indicator of a firm's ability to generate money in the short term is its net working capital, or NWC, which is given to us by current assets minus current liabilities. A positive net working capital is good. It means the company has more cash than it needs to cover all its liabilities for the next 12 months. Unlike the statement of financial position, which captures the value of the firm at a particular point in time, the statement of comprehensive income measures change in value over a period of time, usually a year. The underlying principle behind the statement of comprehensive income is that income equals revenues minus expenses. The revenue here is represented by the net sales. Everything below is an expense, such as cost of goods sold, which accounts for things such as materials and labor, and depreciation, which are amounts we deduct from net sales. We are then left with earnings before interest and taxes, shortened to EBIT, which is an intermediate value useful for calculations that we'll discuss later. From EBIT, you deduct interest, then taxes, and finally you arrive at net income. This is the total amount of money once all the costs of running your business have been accounted for, but this isn't your firm's cash flow. That's because getting to net income requires the deduction of something called non-cash items, which are deducted from revenues on statements, but don't have an impact on the actual cash flow of the firm. Depreciation is one such item. Finally, at the bottom, there's one more important step. Depending on your firm's dividend policy, some percentage of your net income will be paid out to shareholders as dividends. In this case, we can see that the company paid out 10% of its net income as dividends. So how do we calculate cash flow? Well, the cash flow identity is strikingly similar to the statement of financial position identity that we saw earlier. Cash flow from assets equals cash flow to the bondholder plus cash flow to the shareholders. Getting each of these amounts is a simple affair. It only requires adding and subtracting. The only thing you have to be able to do is identify the appropriate values to add and subtract from the financial statements that we discussed earlier. For now, take note of this tree of formulas on how to calculate the various components of cash flow, and we'll explore how it works in practice by doing a few problems. Oakville Pucks Inc. has current assets of $5,100, net fixed assets of $23,800, current liabilities of $4,300, and a long-term debt of $7,400. What is the value of shareholders' equity for this firm? How much is net working capital? So our first step is to set up a statement of comprehensive income with assets listed on the left-hand side and liabilities and equity listed on the right-hand side. So we've got a current asset account of 5,100. We've got a fixed asset account of 23,800. And we've got a current liability account of 4,300. And a long-term debt account of 7,400. And that equals 11,700 total in liabilities. And of course, we also have equities on this side, which we don't know. And that's the value we're calculating for. But we do have the totals for both sides because we know that each side is the same as the other. So total assets is equal to total liabilities plus equity. And adding it up, we get 28,900 for the asset side, which means it's the same amount for liabilities and equities. And we rearrange the statement of comprehensive income's identity, which is A equals L plus E, into solving for E by subtracting liabilities from assets. And when we do this, we subtract 11,700 from 28,900 for a total of 17,200. And that would be the value we plug in here. Now, for net working capital, you remember that our formula was current assets minus current liabilities. And so to get this, we would subtract from 5,100, we would subtract 4,300 for a total of $800. And of course, this is a positive value, so we know that our firm is healthy. Burlington Exterminators Inc. has sales of $586,000, costs of $247,000, depreciation expenses of $43,000, interest expenses of $32,000, and a tax rate of 35%. What is the net income for this firm? Supposing they pay out $73,000 in cash dividends, what is the addition to retained earnings? What is the earnings per share, or EPS, if there are 85,000 shares outstanding? All statements of comprehensive income begin with the sales figure, which represents the revenue, on top of $586,000 in this case, and subtract from it the cost of goods sold and depreciation expenses, which in this case are respectively $247,000 and $43,000. And after we subtract these two values, we get our first intermediate value of earnings before interest and taxes, which should be $296,000. And from that, we subtract our interest, which is $32,000. And we arrive at our second intermediate value of earnings before taxes of $264,000. And now when we're calculating our taxes, which are 35%, we would use the earnings before taxes amount. So 35% of that is $92,400. And that is what we would subtract from the EBT to get a value of $171,600. And that is our net income. And the second part of the question tells us that we pay out dividends of $73,000. So again, we make one final deduction, and our retained earnings are exactly what's left over, so $98,600. Now, we are given an earnings per share to calculate, and we're told that we have 85,000 shares outstanding. So earnings per share is given to us by net income divided by the outstanding shares. And so that would be 171,600 divided by 85,000. And punching that into our calculator, we get a value of $2.02 per share. Cash flow from assets is equal to cash flow to bondholders plus cash flow to shareholders. Cash flow to bondholders is given by interest minus net new long-term debt, which can be further broken down into interest minus long-term debt from the current year, which is 2016, minus long-term debt from the previous year, which is 2015. And these amounts we can just plug in from the financial statement. So 579 minus 15,435 minus 12,700. And that should give us negative 2,156. Cash flow to shareholders is equal to dividends minus net new equity. And that can also be further broken down into dividends minus equity from the current year, minus equity from the previous year, minus additions to retained earnings. And these amounts, again, we can just plug in. So 1,011 minus 32,602 minus 32,309 minus $945.24. And when we add these all up, we get 1,663.24. These two amounts added up give us negative $492.72. Now let's leave that amount up there and attempt to calculate using the CFA formula. And the CFA formula is equal to operating cash flow, OCF, minus capital spending, minus changes to net working capital. OCF is equal to EBIT plus depreciation minus tax. And that is just values that we can plug in. So 3,543 for our EBIT plus 1,085 for our depreciation minus $1,007.76. And that should give us 3,620.24. Capital spending is given by fixed assets from the current year minus fixed assets from the previous year plus depreciation. And that is equal to 33,291 minus 31,805 plus 1,085. And that gives us 2,571. And our final amount is changes to net working capital, which is given to us by net working capital from the current year minus net working capital from the previous year. And again, that can be broken down further into current assets minus current liabilities from 2016 minus current assets minus current liabilities from 2015. And we can plug in these variables fairly simply. So it's 19,488 minus 4,742 minus 17,920 minus 4,716. And when we add these all up, we get 1,542. So with these three amounts, when we subtract them out, we should get the exact same amount. And now, briefly, we'll talk about the statement of cash flows as well as sources and uses of cash. A source of cash is an activity that generates cash, and a use of cash is, well, it uses the firm's cash. It's fairly easy to categorize whether something is a source or a use of cash by referring to a visual tool, like this chart. Let's think about each scenario logically. The firm buys a bunch of new machines for its factory. It's increasing its fixed asset account. To make this purchase, they had to use cash. The company's customers who had purchased their last orders on credit pay down the remaining balance on the sale. This reduces accounts receivable, an asset account, but it is a source of cash for the firm. On the liability side, the company takes a loan, increasing their notes payable account and bringing cash into the firm. This is also a source. Paying down that loan will reduce the notes payable account, but it means using your cash. On the statement of cash flows, shown here, we can further divide our sources and uses of cash depending on the category of activity they fall into: operating, investing, or financing. That brings us to the end of the video. Still confused? Rewind to the relevant part of the video by clicking on the sections listed to the left. For more, be sure to take a look at the tip sheets uploaded to the Academic Success Center website by following the link in the description. Need a more face-to-face approach? Check out tutoring hours at the Ryerson University Academic Success Center's website.